Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then, so today we are going to start the Indigenous Knowledge Process and Technology lecture discussion. So last week, I think we have discussed some very important things regarding the indigenous technologies, and I have uploaded all the materials to the LMS. So today we are going to discuss some very important parts also. It's regarding osmosis. So you know, actually the indigenous people, they used to use some osmosis like technologies for their food preservation technologies. So we will discuss how they have practiced those things in their day-to-day life. And also we will have a discussion regarding how we can use these technologies in the current situation. For the existing practices also, we will be discussing these things. And the last week we have discussed food preservation and drying and dehydration. What are the differences between drying and dehydration? And when it comes to dehydration, it's also a water removal technique, and how it differs from the dry and drying curve, and the differences between sun drying and solar drying also discussed. So I hope that you have a good understanding on these things. And I ask you to think your design for applications. Then actually you can develop your own machines and equipments based on after identification of the errors which are commonly happening in the existing technique, so you can do your innovations as well. So I think the osmotic dehydration is a very common one. You already know what is osmosis and what is the meaning of osmotic dehydration. In this term, you can see take two words, osmotic plus dehydration. So dehydration means you have an understanding on dehydration. It's a process about water removal. So water removal is there. So ultimate objective is water removal is to preserve foods by avoiding microbial attacks. So here we are going to remove water by using osmotic pressure, means osmosis. In the first picture, figure one, you can see how it works. There is a hypotonic solution, might be a osmotic substance. It means a hypotonic solution. It means sometimes maybe salt or sugar-like concentrated solutions. And you can see a piece of fruit here, and you can see how it works. We have dipped. In this example, you can see a fruit sample is inside a type of hypotonic solution. So I hope you know that immersed foods, immersed garlic in bee honey and immersed meat in bee honey. So by considering those examples, those very popular examples, the bee honey is a hypotonic solution. So its water percentage is very low. So then what happened when we put a piece of food item into the type of hypotonic solution, then water will remove from inside to outside. Here you can see how it water moves from inside the food to outside, right? Based on the concentration difference. And osmotic substance, it means maybe bee honey or maybe sugar or maybe salt, like they will move from outside to inside. Then the water percentage of the food item will decrease, and in the hypotonic solution, the water percentage will increase. So as a result of that, at the end of this process, you can see, you can feel and you can see the dried food. So as a result of that, microbial growth will decrease. In the second picture, you can see how it happens. So in the In this picture, there is a semi-permeable membrane and osmosis is there. So sugar solution you can see in red color, and from the blue color you can see water. Then you can understand how it happens and how the blood pressure is there. So you need not to understand, you need not to go through these things in detail, but you just understand what is osmosis and what is the meaning of osmotic dehydration. It means concentration difference is there. So as a result of that, and the hypertonic solution will move to the different sides. And here I'm going to show you a video which I have taken from in Dambana. We have conducted survey in Dambana with your senior students, but unfortunately you are not allowed to go there now due to the COVID situation, but we will try in our best to go there after solve this problem even up to some extent. So I'm going to show you how they preserve meat inside biryani. So carefully watch this video, how they are doing these things. Can you see the video?
Yes, sir.
In this video, you can see how they are doing their preservation. So they use fresh bee honey for their process. And here you can see a clay pot, and they put the meat, the very clean meat, into the pot, and then they pour bee honey on those meat particles. So you can see.
Udah lama nggak cek.
Okay, I think it's clear. So in this video clip, you can you will be able to identify how they practice these things in their day-to-day life. So then osmotic dehydration is a partial removal of water due to osmosis. As we discussed, there is a concentration deviation of those two solvents. Inside of the food, you know, the water is there. So as a result of that, the exterior solution, the concentration is very high. So as a result of this concentration deviation, based on that pressure, water will move from inside to outside. And normally food is dried by immersing into the hypertonic solution, maybe sodium chloride, it means salt, and fructose, bee honey, like natural honey and sugary concentrated liquids are also using. Water from the food is leached out and the solid in the resulting syrup. So here, then water will move from one side to other side until come to the equilibrium level, right? And it will consume very less energy. So the shelf life is more than 2-3 years. You can preserve the food for more than 2-3 years, but always think on the quality of the hypertonic solution. So if it is a high moisture solution, so it's very difficult to preserve foods. And when we are taking food items, as an example, you've seen in the last previous video, so they have used some meat varieties, meat pieces of meat. So in cleaning those meat varieties, you have to clean it well and place inside the clay pot. But here you can see they are using, normally we are using clay pots. So why is that? So we can use some aluminium pots and we can use some pots made of other materials, but basically the recommended material is clay pots. So why is that? You have to think it. And it's a low cost method and product can be dried after pre-treatment, right? And there are two stages. First, elimination of moisture by an osmotic agent, then dehydration in a dry dehydrator. So you can do these two things, or maybe a single thing also possible. But in the market, you can't see this type. The dehydrated foods are available, immersed food are available. But as a result of these combination of these two methods, you can get a nice product. So I propose you. Then we can do some research activities by using these two techniques together. So initially we can dry, we can put the product inside a concentrated solution. Then we can take it out and dehydrate, right? Then inside the food, you know, the hypertonic solution is there and the
improved flavor is there, right? And while we are processing, while we are conducting this technique, then enzyme inhibition, microbiological reactions, and they are going. We can control these things, right? But when it comes to a heat-based process, you know, enzyme deactivation is there, and the quality will also change. But in this type of food products, you can see quality deviations are very low, and flavor also will increase. Enhanced flavor we can get, and aroma and the shelf life also very high. So therefore, the indigenous people, they have used this type of techniques for very susceptible food items. You know, meat, fish-like products are very highly susceptible for microbial attack. So therefore, those peoples, they have used this type of techniques to preserve such highly susceptible food items for a long time period. And the cost is very low, nutritional security is there, and the sensorial quality also very good. And you can see some experiments conducted based on the osmotic dehydration. You can see how the texture will deviate it, and the texture changes in this picture. You can see these things. And there are some market available products. This type of products are available in the Sri Lankan market also. But if you go to Thailand market, when you go to Thailand market, you can see such products. In Thailand and Vietnam like countries, they are using this type of dehydrated products. They consume this type of products for their three meals, and even for their as for their desserts. So, but in our country, we have not yet used such techniques for our day-to-day activities. But we are used to consume some. We are used to prepare some curries and rice and curry food products or fried rice like food products. But it's not very popular among the Sri Lankans. And here you can see some preserved food items. These things are there are some popular food products are available. Then another technique is salted dry. It's also very popular food products in Sri Lanka. Dried fish, we call it as dried fish, but in this type of dried fish preparation, salt should be there. So we can get the salt from the sea, it's freely available. But nowadays, we have visited the Mirissa Fishery Harbor last week for a research activity. But the people who are doing this business, they told us that the fishermen also carrying a lot of the salt to their boats. Then what they are doing is they open the fish, they cut fish and put some salt on their boats, right? Not on the after reach to the harbor, but they are doing these things on the boat, because you know the trawler boats, they travel for around 30 to 45 days to catch fish. But in this period, they are also adding some salt and sugar for their fish produce to extend the shelf life, right? So, but basically we are adding salt in preparation of dried fish. We have very good demand in Sri Lanka for dried fish, but unfortunately we are importing dried fish and Maldive fish from other countries. That's so we can do something for that bad practice. So we have very good fish. We have good sunlight also available entire day, and we have the oceans, everything we have. But unfortunately, still we are importing dried fish. The purpose of salting in preparation of salt dried fish. For the first thing is dehydration by removing free water, and preservation, natural preservation is there, and to get the unique flavor. So we can dry fish without adding some salt, then you can imagine the flavor. So it is difficult. It will be difficult to market such product. So therefore, the salt plus sunlight should be there to prepare such dried fish. But basically, it's a type of dehydration technique, and natural preservation is there. And there are some products available in Sri Lanka and also the internationally available products. The bacon, you can see, how it preserves bacon, right? Here also we are adding some salt, and sometimes we are adding sugar also, right? And potassium nitrate also we are using. In the meat industry, saltpeter, it means potassium nitrate and sugar. We are using these two products together for the, in here you can see, because sugar counter-reacts the salty taste and provide the bacteria with energy to transform the nitrates into nitrites, right? As a result of this nitrite, the meat color will also improve to pink color. So you can see very interesting color after adding salt, pepper and sugar together. So that's why we are adding these two things together in the meat industry, right? And there are some products, sauerkraut and Roman garum also, very popular food product. Here also they are adding, they are doing some salting and fermentation. There are two basic process. It's a very common food product. And garum, it's a type of very popular food product in the southern South Asian countries. So here you also, you can see they are using some salt like hypodermic solutions in preparing this type of food product. So in bilimbi, you can, it's also a very popular food product in Sri Lanka, salted lime and salt dried bilimbi. How to prepare those food items? First, you have to select the matured one, then clean it and sort it, then dry it up to some extent using the solar dry. It's freely available. Then we dry the green bilimbi up to some extent. By practice, we know the limits. The color, we know up to what color, up to what texture we have to dry, right? Then solar dry to reduce the moisture content up to some extent, not to remove all the water. Then mix it adequate amount of salt powder and put into the airtight containers, right? In your home, you can develop such products, but we have very good market for such products. This is one of the very popular product in Sri Lanka. So you know how to prepare it by using salt. Right, then you can do some trials with sugar also and bee honey, like products, naturally available products. You can use such different ingredients, different hypodermic solutions to preserve life, right? But still we have only sour lime, but you can prepare sweet lime, right? You can prepare sweet lime and it will you will have a good market. So, and the next thing is this is very important. The first picture I have obtained from, I have taken in Dabban again. You can see how they use smoke drying procedure, how they are doing, how they are practicing these things in an actual scenario. So you can see some meat and fish variety, fish pieces, clean meat and fish on this wooden chamber. Like they are preparing this chamber using some wooden material. So what are the importance of this method? Right here you can see how they are doing. You can see in this video. Okay. first they clean those food materials and check on this wood particles. You can see raw meat and raw fish here. Right. So the preparation of this wooden chamber, wooden rack, is very important. How to do it? So you have to take, you have to select non-poison wooden materials, right? There are some specific wood types. By their knowledge, indigenous knowledge, they know what types of materials are suitable for this for this process, and they use some ropes to prepare this structure. And the height is very important. How to maintain this height? It's again very important. And the heat, how to control heat, right? There is no method to control the heat. So you can adjust the height of this machine, right? Adjust the height of this machine and you can add some wood pieces here, right? Then you can see the texture of this food material. You can see the texture. They are not using the entire fish, right? They are not using the entire fish only. There are some slices. You can see some slices are there, or half fish, right? The objective of this size reduction is to do this smoke drying process quickly, right? If not, it will take much time. And sometimes some texture changes might happen. So indigenous knowledge is very important in conducting this type of practices, right? So smoke drying is food preservation by removing water due to the chemicals available in smoke and heat. Here we are going to use two things. First thing is the heat generated by the flame. The other thing is smoke. Right? Smoke drying is one of the oldest method of food preservation, employing from heat from sun, smoke and atmospheric air. Advantages of smoke drying is it preserves food and enhances the flavor while preserving those foods by insects, right? Since sun drying is taken length time for drying, sun drying is supplemented along with the smoke to get the better product. So we can use some hybrid techniques. But nowadays in Sri Lanka, we are using, if we are going to use sun drying, so the entirely we are going to use sun drying for the entire process. But we are not thinking on hybrid processes. So we can include smoke drying plus sun drying, right? Up to some extent, we can remove water by using sun drying, then we can go for smoke drying, right? And type of the fuel, the wood types are also very important. I have taken these things from, I asked these things from our ancient people, our Vedas. They told us that firewood, they use seru, lihinia, velan-like wood materials, but not they are not using valiko, kaduru, mill-like varieties for this process. So what is the objective of that method, of that selection? To get the flavor, to avoid the toxicity generation, to avoid sometimes there might be some toxics. So avoid these things. Indigenous knowledge is important, but and also to get the texture and a good product, right? Sometimes we can use different types of food materials. May might be cinnamon like wood. So what happened then? A new flavor will be there, or flavor will be there, and toxicity will also be there. So therefore, it is important to get the indigenous knowledge from them. Or if not, nowadays we can go for some research activities by using different types of wood materials and different types of techniques, right? In smoke drying, normally they smoke for around 2 to 3 hours at 70 to 80 degrees of Celsius. And sometimes we can use a mild temperatures also, but it will take much time. So time is very long, right? Around 1 to 2 days. It will take around 1 to 2 days, right? And as I told you earlier, meat or fish should be cut into a specific uniform shape that permits the equal and simultaneous drying of all parts, edges of the food. After smoke drying, weight loss is there. So it's around 60 to 70%. So it means you can understand the water removal capacity in meat products. You know, around 80 to 90% of water is there, but now we have around 30 to 40% of water, because there is a loss around 60 to 70%. So likewise, in the smoke drying process, we have several advantages and also some disadvantages as well. So what I am telling these things to you, then you can grab their knowledge and turn these knowledge and use their knowledge to develop, to do some innovations, right? Then you can see how they are shape up those food products, how to cut these things into a specific but uniform taste shape. And two types of smoking techniques are available, cold smoking and hot smoking. When it comes to cold smoking, we have two different words here, cold and hot. So you can understand what is the meaning of cold. So temperature is somewhat reduced one, somewhat low temperature. And here you can see the temperature is around 20 to 30 degrees of Celsius. But for the hot smoking process, the temperature will be around 50 to 80, somewhat around higher temperature. So, and the other thing, other difference is, if it is a cold smoke product, then we have to cook it before consuming, right? So just smoke products. So we have to cook it. So cold smoke products are not ready to eat products. So they are ready to cook products. So before consuming, we have to cook it and eat, right? But if it is a hot smoke product, so the temperature, you know, it's around somewhat high temperature, 50 to 80. So therefore, we can eat such hot smoke product without cooking, right? It means such products are ready to eat. So cold smoke product are ready to cook, hot smoke product are ready to eat. So these are the two techniques of smoking. And in food smoking, there are some very important things, right? So you can see the texture and the color, and what happened when we increase the temperature, the texture, what happened to the texture and surface area and thickness, also very important in food smoking and drying. So you should have a knowledge too, and or maybe it might be experience in smoking, because if not, the texture and the quality will not good after the smoke dry. And you can see the texture with the temperature. If it is a raw product, you can see the color, and dried product, you can see the color with different temperatures, right? I have obtained this picture from a research paper. So you can see the color changes and textural changes in these two samples with different temperature conditions, right? So it is important to maintain the temperature and the time and the nutrition level also in this type of smoking and drying or smoke drying process. What is case hardening? I hope that you are aware, you are familiar with this case hardening technique and scenario. So it is actually a, you can see some examples here. So case hardening is it is commonly happen in meat industry, and sometimes it's very good example. What happened when we in when we fry some meat products, right? And you can see this, you can identify the case hardening in vade, right? Vade, you can see some, sometimes it's the crust is very hard, but the inside you can see some uncooked materials, right? You will have, you should have this experience, right? Here there are two moving methods, paths. First, when we put such food into a heated oil or in a heated chamber or in smoking also, then water will move from inside to the surface first, then from surface to the atmosphere, right? When we put this type of meat products or any food item in a hot environment, then what happened? Water will evaporate it. Then there are two paths, from inside to the texture and the crust, from crust to the environment, right? Then there is equilibrium, diffusion rate and evaporation rate. Diffusion rate means the rate, the moving rate from inside to the this surface, right? The evaporation means from the surface to the environment. If those two rates are similar, then we call it as the equilibrium state, right? When moisture from the surface of food is being removed, the rate is higher than the diffusion rate, then a hardening of the outer surface can be seen, can be observed. So what happened? Here we are going to remove the moisture from the top of this surface. Then it means that the evaporation rate is high, right? Diffusion rate is low. Then what happened? When we increase the temperature quickly, then you can observe these things. Then the evaporation rate is very high, but diffusion rate is comparatively low. As a result of that, case hardening will happen. It usually happens at low humidity and fast air flows. It means sometimes we are going to increase the flame. If it is a gas cooker, gas burner, then to avoid the time consumption, we are going to we use some to get the highest heat, high heat, we increase the flame rate, flame, and as a result of that, this type of quality deviations might be occurred. Then finally, what happened? You can get a hardened surface will retard the free diffusion of the interior water. Therefore, moist interior becomes susceptible to microbial spoilage. What happened then? Then diffusion rate, evaporation is higher, diffusion rate is very low. Then what happened? The inside, you can see some moisture. Then what happened? The crust is very hard. So it is very difficult to move water from inside to outside now, because the hard crust. Then what happened? Water will trap inside. Water will trap inside. Then there is a tendency, positive environment for microbial growth. Then humidity is there, microbes will grow and the food will spoil early than the fresh food. So therefore, you have to avoid the case hardening. So for that one also, we should have experience how to control the temperature, how to control the flame, and how to and the rates diffusion rate and evaporation rates. So it's very important. So finally, the product texture and flavor is not good due to the case hardening. To avoid case hardening, meat are usually fermented at very high humidity settings with slow airflow. So first ferment it and then going to provide the heat. It's a one good example, right? Then I hope that's clear. Then you and also you can see the pictures also. So case hardening, it's a bad one. Smoke drying, both high percentage of fatty tissues in the raw meat and high temperatures during meat drying and storage cause intensive oxidation, right? It means sometimes, as an example, pork-like meat varieties, right? Pork. So the fat percentage is very high, right? Then what happened when we apply high temperature, then intensive oxidation will be there. It means a rancidity. So as a result of that, then you know what is rancidity. A rancid flavor will be there and the food also not good for the consumption. So that's why I ask you to go through these things and study the indigenous technologies. They use the flame rate and the temperature and the height, maintenance of that height is very important. If not, and the people they have used, they have selected some special wooden materials and food varieties. So we can't do the same principle for all food items. So type of the food also important, particle sizes and the surface area also important and height also important. So everything is important in smoke drying. If not, there are some shortcomings. Right, and here you can see some example, some data regarding the fresh fish and dried fish. Before a smoke drying and after smoke drying, you can see the moisture content. What happened here? 67, but here only 4. And protein level also increased because now the moisture level is not very reduced. Moisture level is there. Here, you know, around 80 to 90% of moisture, but here around 40% of moisture. So, the finally the protein level will also increase, and ash fat, everything will be increased, right? And the moisture content you can see here 68, here 6, almost 10% reduction is there. 10 times reduction is there, right? So osmotic, we have discussed about osmotic dehydration and some smoke dehydration, right? So these are very important and frequently used techniques in indigenous food processing. So you have to read and study these techniques. They are very general. I think you can easily understand. You can get the data and from internet, and the method also are very common. And you can do. You can practice these technologies in your home also. But how to mechanize these things? How to enhance the quality? How to enhance the productivity is very important, right? So please go through these slides. And always try to do some innovations. You can develop some techniques to control the heat of these indigenous methods. And you can develop some techniques to identify the case hardening and to control case hardening, right? Such equipments and methods are there. And sometimes and other research, other new product also, these are my ideas, but you will have very good ideas, I suppose. So a color code, how to develop a color code, how to identify the raw fish, how to identify the smoke fish, how to increase the efficiency of smoking, right? This type of new products are there, apps are there. So you can do these things as technology students, right? And how to avoid case hardening, then there will be some recommendations, right? Based on your research, you can give some recommendations. The optimum temperature for chicken is around 60. So you can suggest. And for this type of meat, the temperature will be around 100. Likewise, you can decide based on your experience. So I propose, I always telling you to try to do something different than the things doing others. In other universities, you can see they have same lectures. They have same qualified lecturers are there. They are also doing lectures, but we are also doing lectures. You are also students. They are also students. But how to do different things, new things. It's very important, right? I hope that there are no more questions. So these are very general and very common things, osmosis and smoke drive. So if you have any questions, now you can ask. So if not, I'm going to wind up the session because today the environment condition is not good. So there are some disturbance also. So forget about these things. I hope that you have taken something from these slides. And I have some other pictures also and video clips. I will share these things on LMS. Then you can watch these videos. And osmotic dehydration, how to control these, the osmotic pressure is very important. And salting also. Then you can, you will have a different idea. If some products are available in your area or your village, then you can use such products as concentrated solution. So please search and seek these things and let us know. So thank you very much. Since there are no more questions, so today I'm going to stop the lecture a little early due to this bad environmental condition. So thank you very much and have a nice day.